Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Other People's Wars, The U.S. Military and the Challenge of Learning from Foreign Conflicts, by Brent L. Sterling, narrated by Sean Runnette. Introduction. Happily, we may profit by the experience of others without suffering the evils that attend the practical solution of such problems. Secretary of War Jefferson Davis. On Thursday, April 5th, 1855, three highly regarded soldiers, Major Richard Delafield, Major Alfred Mordecai, and Captain George McClellan, entered the War Department building, located just northwest of the White House, to be briefed on their unprecedented mission. Awaiting them was Jefferson Davis, whose heroic exploits as commander of the 1st Mississippi Rifles in the Mexican-American War had propelled him to prominence and his current office. Victory in that conflict, less than 10 years earlier, instilled a healthy confidence in the U.S. officer corps about its ability to meet defense challenges. Davis, not wanting the Army to rest on its laurels, dispatched this trio, subsequently known as the Delafield Commission, to observe the ongoing combat between three of Europe's leading military powers. Physical distance, combined with diplomatic obstacles, meant they disappointingly did not reach the Crimean Peninsula until just after the British and French captured Sebastopol. Still, when the weary soldiers sat down again with the secretary 13 months after that initial meeting, the commissioners possessed a wealth of information. For example, the group documented the outstanding performance of the new French 12-pound field artillery piece, the failure of the much-touted British Lancaster 68-pound rifled artillery gun, and the increased power projection capabilities of modern militaries. Davis and other American decision-makers had to assess whether these findings were accurate lessons about contemporary war, and whether they should be applied by the U.S. Army. The answers were mixed. The service eagerly embraced the French 12-pounder, which provided excellent support as the primary field gun for both the U.S. Army and Confederate Army in the Civil War. Information on the Lancaster gun's failing imbued War Department leaders with confidence in the continuing viability of masonry fortifications. But such works proved highly vulnerable from April 1862 with the introduction of effective rifled artillery. The U.S. government largely ignored as irrelevant the overarching lessons about the expanded scale of war and power projection potential, contributing to the chaotic scramble at the outset of the internecine American fight and potential danger if the British and French allied with the Confederacy. Although widespread belief exists in the military ranks that victory smiles upon those who anticipate the changes in the character of war, not upon those who wait to adapt themselves after the changes occur, soldiers, sailors, marines, and aviators struggle with foreseeing shifts in combat dynamics and fear errant choices. Based on their experience, imagination, and study of highly regarded foreign armed services, officers devise or copy new weapons, alternative organizational structures, modified training regimes, and innovative tactical and operational concepts. Before introducing such reforms, the services attempt to validate their merit through experiments, field trials, and war games. Truthful evaluations require realism and rigor, but satisfying those conditions is difficult for cultural, informational, fiscal, and safety reasons. Even when evidence supports proposed measures, reluctance often exists to initiate major adjustments. As Stephen Rosen opines, military organizations are large bureaucracies, and almost everything we know in theory about large bureaucracies suggests not only that they are hard to change, but they are designed not to change. As a result, battle-tested practices usually act as a cognitive anchor long after the war in which they occurred. Unsurprisingly, militaries tend to struggle at the outset of conflicts. Given the difficulty in pre-war preparation, some military historians stress the importance of adaptability after fighting commences. To enable such interwar changes, the U.S. and other militaries have developed robust programs to learn from their combat experiences. Yet, proficiency at adaptability does not eliminate the significance of pre-war preparation. Even historians stressing such learning acknowledge that taking advantage of new data is heavily dependent on the soundness of the service's pre-war foundation. Moreover, at times, the gap between opposing forces is so great that the opening campaign proves determinative, rendering adaptability irrelevant. Plus, a credible standing military capability has critical importance for states' abilities to deter aggression and thus avoid war. The very term war game, Kriegsspiel, reflects the desire to discern deficiencies without actual combat. Unfortunately, informational benefits of such simulations do not match the data provided by actual combat. Officials have even suggested manufacturing modest military action purely for knowledge acquisition. For example, Assistant Secretary of the Navy Theodore Roosevelt advocated in late 1897 for a Cuban landing, if only for the sake of learning from our own blunders. Such provocative behavior, however, rarely if ever occurs in modern times. The best potential source of battlefield knowledge outside of one's own combat is other people's wars. But learning from such events is challenging. For an army that had been at peace for many years, German military theorist Karl von Clausewitz recommended that some officers should be sent to observe operations and learn what war is like. Whether or not armed forces have recent fighting experience, as William McBride notes, other people's wars have been touchstones for modern military professionals. Even conflicts between smaller, less powerful nations have potential for revealing the effects of new technology, tactics, or systems. Andrew Krepinevich characterizes such battles as precursor wars, the neglect of which imperils major powers existing in an unstable security environment. Nevertheless, the extent to which attempts at learning from these events has led to better preparedness is an open question. The idiosyncratic nature and investigatory difficulty of foreign wars complicates accurately capturing what happened. Historian Robert Cetino pessimistically writes that external conflict examination since its 19th century origin has proven a highly problematic venture, one that resists any kind of scientific or objective standards. Even with accurate data, doubt exists to its relevancy. President Theodore Roosevelt cautioned the U.S. Army Chief of Staff after the Russo-Japanese War against following in servile fashion the victorious Japanese, because not all of the things they have done have been wise, and some of the wise things they have done are not wise for us. Sound advice, but such guidance is prone to abuse if findings suggest the need for bureaucratically or culturally unappealing changes. We need to better understand the dynamics of learning from foreign wars to avoid recurring pitfalls and maximize their utility. This subject has been neglected, in contrast to an extensive literature examining learning from one's own experiences. Previous works have consisted of either single-case victories, for example Greenwood, Huntanen, Moten, or investigation of multiple experiences from a single war or era, for example Luvas, O'Connor, Vaca. These studies yield insights about the practical challenges involved in such efforts and some ability to consider the relative merit of contrasting approaches. They, however, preclude discovery of recurring obstacles and enablers of success across different periods and contexts. The potential to obtain such understanding exists from an exploration of multiple attempts by a single military over an extended period as it developed institutionally and as the nature of war evolved. Completing such an investigation involves answering a series of distinct but related questions. How did the service attempt to discover what happened? What types of lessons were identified and what were missed? When, why, and how did the service apply its findings? What accounts for the resistance to using such information, and was such pushback appropriate? Why did implementation at times provide effectiveness, but in other cases prove counterproductive in preparing for future war? How do the dynamics of such learning efforts differ from attempts to benefit from one's own experiences? To answer these questions, I conduct an inductive investigation through a series of in-depth case studies. The work, however, has been informed by three interrelated literatures that address aspects of learning and military change. The first and most developed area attempts to understand why militaries innovate, why they initiate significant reforms that produce improved battlefield performance. One school of thought stresses the role of external, civilian pressure, often in cooperation with maverick officers, in overcoming an institutional reluctance to adjust. Yet the frequent failure of even highly motivated civilians to achieve their desired objective has led others to place the primary onus for innovation within militaries. A range of distinct explanations exist for such internally directed change, including the armed forces' position in the governing process, inter-service competition for scarce reasons, and inter-service dynamics. For intra-service dynamics, improvement results when proponents of a new theory of victory, especially senior officers, successfully combine collected evidence with internal politics to prevail over status quo preferring forces. Scholars have increasingly stressed the role of organizational culture as a factor in promoting or frustrating change, given its effects on the collection, evaluation, communication, and embrace of new knowledge. No theoretical reason exists to dismiss or give an a priori preference to any of these explanations when considering the influence of combat lessons from a foreign war. Given the relatively limited and hard-to-acquire data compared to that available from one's own experiences, one might expect the increased need for external pressure to learn from a foreign war. Yet findings from such conflicts, especially those of modest political significance, are likely to be of much greater interest to military audiences, fueling inter- and intra-services battles over how best to react. For insights into the process by which militaries assess the desirability and practicality of responding to external cues, the literature on the diffusion of military power is instructive. This subfield focuses not on the initial innovation, but on the transfer of that knowledge throughout the international system. Whereas neorealists expect competition between states to precipitate uniform diffusion, these scholars stress that it varies with the social, cultural, organizational, and political context. Researchers have identified a number of reasons why nations embrace or reject major military innovations, including cost requirements, degree of organizational decentralization, veto points, ability to experiment, breadth of organizational focus, mission, and compatibility, perceived fit of innovation with organizational culture, values, and needs. This literature also makes clear that rather than a binary adopt-not-adopt decision, militaries pursue a range of responses. Copy, selectively emulate, modify for different circumstances, counter, neglect due to low priority, or reject. Despite the relevance of the diffusion research, some notable differences exist. First, their unit of investigation is a development. For example, a major military innovation, compared to an event, for example, a foreign war, with potentially many meaningful lessons, big and small, on a wide range of topics. Second, diffusion scholars' interest begins only when the international community has sufficient data, a demonstration point, about an innovation's effectiveness, unlike foreign war investigators. The literature on organizational learning and knowledge management provides insights about the collection of information as well as the understanding of what militaries do with that data. Scholars in this field point out that lesson drawing begins with individuals either through experience, hands-on, or reflection, reading, listening, thinking. For these discoveries to be beneficial, the organization must have structures and processes to transition such findings into institutional learning via knowledge acquisition, analysis, dissemination, and absorption stages. Achievement of this goal requires satisfying three conditions, as Janine Davidson explains. There must be clarity and consensus regarding the events that occurred, what happened or what is happening, what those events mean, why this matters to our organization, and what the proper course of action should be, what should be done about it. Research has shown that certain factors enhance military learning, such as information flow, horizontal as well as vertical, commitment to rigorous experimentation, openness to disruptive data, and a collective problem-solving mentality. Moreover, leadership plays a significant role in strongly hierarchical organizations, such as the uniformed services, either facilitating or impeding knowledge growth. Finally, lesson drawing needs to be prospective, considering whether what is successfully done today will improve conditions in the future. This task is particularly difficult, but essential for militaries, who are engaged in dynamic and obscure competition with adversaries simultaneously adjusting. The U.S. military has attempted to apply these insights in developing an increasingly sophisticated program to learn from its own experiences. Such learning largely occurs from the bottom up, as frontline units discover deficiencies with the status quo from combat and even exercises. Case studies documenting this process have prompted criticism of the aforementioned innovation theories for disproportionately weighing top-down change mechanics. While scholars have explored more integrative models, militaries have attempted to improve the collection and use of bottom-up inputs. Struggles in Afghanistan and Iraq reinforced for the U.S. services the benefit of becoming more effective learning organizations. For one's own experiences, soldiers, sailors, aviators, and Marines are present at the information source. But effective collection of information on a foreign conflict requires a dedicated effort initiated by the leadership. Thus, learning from other people's wars is largely a top-down process. Moreover, the assessment and reaction to findings occurs in distinct decision contexts. During war, a necessary delegation of authority to the tactical level abets rapidly translating battlefield discoveries of best practices and issues needing resolution into improved performance. In peacetime, when considering lessons from foreign wars, military organizations revert to their strongly hierarchical nature and display reluctance to accept findings that diverge from the sentiment of the service's leadership and organizational culture. While these contextual differences will likely lead to distinct approaches for maximum learning, shared core elements of the tasks allow taking advantage of the well-established definitions used by the U.S. military for its own experiential learning when characterizing key terminology for the investigation of foreign wars. Beginning in the late 1980s, after a long failure to delineate terms, especially lessons learned, the Army issued formal definitions as a part of the effort to standardize and enhance learning from its own experiences. The U.S. military has refined this terminology through several generations of guidance over the last 30 years. As a result, the current versions clearly and accurately depict the basic process elements, so I use them in this study. Of course, participants in the pre-1980s cases did not possess such clarification, and at times used words, especially learning, in different ways. Such a tendency does not present a difficulty as long as I maintain consistency in what is actually occurring. The process begins at the information gathering stage with the collection of observations, insights, and lessons. The most recent Army Lessons Learned program guidance defines an observation as a statement of the conditions experienced or observed with recommended changes to improve performance, and a lesson as a potential solution to a problem experienced as a result of an observation. Importantly, this document conveys the value of both positive, evidence supporting sustainment, as well as negative, evidence of need for improvement or change, data. Most critically, what is a lesson learned? Scholars and practitioners appropriately differentiate between drawing a lesson and learning a lesson. The latter requires application of the former. What is meant by application, however, is a source of disagreement. Some commentators limit learning to organizational action. Typifying many commentators, Robert Foley, Stuart Griffin, and Helen McCartney contend that only when positive change has been made can a lesson really be said to have been learned. Similarly, the most recent Joint Chiefs of Staff Joint Lessons Learned Program, JLLP, guidance characterizes a lesson learned as an operationalized, resolved issue or best practice that resulted in behavioral change and improved operations or activities. Beneficial impacts can occur across the full spectrum of doctrine, organization, training, materiel, leadership, personnel, facilities, and policy, DOTMLPFP. But decision-makers attach particular attention to the first four subjects. Yet the requirement of adjustment for learning to take place omits two valuable uses of collected information. First, consideration of other people's mistakes can prevent adoption of harmful changes previously under consideration by revealing what not to do. Second, findings may indicate the continuing viability of existing DOTMLPFP. As the 2005 version of the JLLP guidance states, a lesson learned also results from evaluation or observation of a positive finding that did not necessarily require corrective action other than sustainment. Such effects should not be dismissed as of trivial importance, given doubt about status quo methods and techniques the more time passes from a prior war and the emergence of alternative approaches and new technology. As I noted, consideration of a single military's efforts to learn lessons from foreign wars offers an unexplored way to identify recurring challenges and issues, as well as potentially ameliorating measures in this nuanced, multi-stage process. Although a half dozen militaries qualify as potential candidates, I selected the U.S. Armed Forces, given the varied environments in which it has conducted such investigations and the relative availability of information. My initial thought was to examine a combination of conventional wars and counterinsurgencies, but I decided to concentrate on the former because extended U.S. operations in Afghanistan and Iraq over the last 20 years have prompted numerous studies of prior counterinsurgency efforts, for example, the British in Malaya, the French in Algeria, and their impact on the U.S. Army. Rather than rehash this terrain, I consider learning from four conventional wars between the 1850s and 1970s. During this span, the active army transitioned from a small, decentralized, 15,000-man force with minimal investigative capability to a large, complex, nearly 800,000-man institution with expansive analytical and educational components. Given that most research on this subject has focused on ground forces, I also consider how either the U.S. Navy or U.S. Army Air Corps Air Force responded to each conflict. The study begins with the Crimean War. The Army's Delafield Commission marked the first major American attempt to observe a foreign war, occurring only a half decade before the U.S. Civil War. The Navy conducted no formal fact-finding assessment, but key U.S. sailors sought insights at a time of rapidly evolving technology. The Russo-Japanese War offers a case of strong interest for the Army and Navy, both undergoing substantial institutional development and facing notable technological changes. 30 years later, after significant post-World War I improvements to the tank and aircraft, the Army leadership appreciated the potential of the Spanish Civil War to yield valuable information about the evolution of modern war. This case technically involves only the Army, but the Army Air Corps operated with considerable autonomy and possessed a sharply divergent perspective on the Iberian struggle. Finally, the Yom Kippur War warrants inclusion as the most extensive, by far, American foreign war investigation. As the Army and Air Force transitioned from a focus on the Vietnam War to the Soviet threat in Central Europe, U.S. officers regarded the intense, lethal Arab-Israeli fighting as almost a proxy for combat with the Russians. Each case study starts by considering the way in which the services collected data. Then I identify what information each institution obtained and what it missed and why. Subsequently, I explore efforts to apply findings, especially to doctrine, organization, training, and materiel. Some applications involve maintaining the status quo, but most are adjustments, either innovations, transformative changes, or adaptations, incremental changes. Whereas military change scholars have long focused on innovation, they have increasingly appreciated that adaptation is not less significant in facilitating preparedness. Although apportioning responsibility for multi-causal actions is an admittedly hard task, understanding organizational learning is not possible without careful assessment of how a service used the data. The skewed emphasis on the discovery phase in previous studies of foreign war investigations has, I believe, accounted for an excessive dismissiveness of findings' impact as commentators look for the rare instances in which a lesson provides the sole impetus for change. Such a perspective neglects the often meaningful contribution of insights in shifting the balance of argument in ongoing debates. This impact reflects what scholars describe as a key for organizational learning: how to integrate acquired knowledge into existing knowledge to facilitate superior understanding and improved practices. The subsequent case studies revealed that applied findings from foreign wars benefited the U.S. services in three basic ways: instrumentally, instructionally, and inspirationally. That is, the combat, one, generated compelling evidence used to overcome resistance from military and/or civilian officials to doing what had already been recognized as necessary by a group of officers, a force subcomponent, or even the entire service. Two, provided insights on how to better prepare for and conduct martial affairs. And three, sparked recognition or increased appreciation of battlefield challenges requiring resolution, and even at times fueled imaginative responses. Although the U.S. military's learning capacity and performance generally improved, except for the Spanish Civil War case, recurring pitfalls in both the discovery, for example, allowing pre-existing preferences to corrupt interpretations of what happened, and application, for example, embracing cues that rapidly became obsolete, stages impeded performance. The book's conclusion lays out the most problematic hazards for learning lessons and considers how best to overcome or minimize their impact. Looking for practical benefits from investigations of other people's wars, the U.S. military, especially the Army, has tended toward rapidly drawing preliminary findings and seeking hard, quantitative data to support such insights. While producing some notable benefits, this orientation problematically discourages attention to operational and strategic elements and dangerously promotes static, not dynamic, learning. A more effective approach requires broadening both the investigative scope and perceived applicability of findings. That is, rather than a tasking-driven exploration of subjects deemed highly relevant to the service mission, the endeavor needs to encompass as full a history as possible and respond to cues in areas of potential, not just current, relevance. Such a perspective protects against mistaken assumptions about what will be germane, especially once salient areas of warfare not regarded as relevant today are almost always less well understood, and thus where the institution would gain the most from applying foreign war information. To best contribute to military preparedness, lessons learned should not only strengthen core competencies, but also enhance adaptability, given the likelihood of the next war occurring in an unanticipated manner. As part of this effort, the armed forces must consider not only a foreign war's combat, but also what other militaries identified as lessons from the conflict and their application of that information. How I arrive at this somewhat contrarian perspective in favor of a broadened effort requires returning to 1855. and considering that and subsequent American experiences. Chapter 1. The Crimean War. Partial but precedent-setting probe. The contest that commenced in 1854 between the principled military and naval powers of Europe gave rise, during its progress, to the belief that the art of war had undergone some material changes since the days of Napoleon and Wellington. Major Richard Delafield, USA. The Crimean War, the first major conflict between European great powers since the Napoleonic era, generated considerable attention in the United States. Diplomats and politicians weighed the foreign policy implications, while a curious public devoured unprecedented coverage from far-off battlefields. The most interested Americans were those in the business of war. Reflective of this last group, Commodore David Farragut, U.S. Navy, requested in April 1854 appointment to any commission or command sent to the deployed English and French fleets, with a view to ascertaining whether in the outfits and preparations for war they possess any advantages over our ships of war, and if so, in what they consist. Although duty necessitated that Farragut follow events from California, his father, brother, and future fellow admiral, Lieutenant David Dixon Porter, reached the Crimean Theater in late 1855. Secretary of War Jefferson Davis, an inquisitive military reformer, would undoubtedly have leaped at a similar chance. His position precluded such a journey, leaving him to scrutinize battlefield reports and track fighting forces on a large map in his office. More importantly, Davis convinced President Franklin Pierce to approve an unprecedented visit by an American military commission to a theater of war. This chapter explores the U.S. Army and U.S. Navy efforts to learn from this largely forgotten but militarily significant struggle, which included the battlefield introduction of significant technologies, for example, rifled cannons, submarine mines, armored warships. These initial endeavors serve as a benchmark against which to judge subsequent American attempts at learning from foreign wars. How did the Americans attempt to identify lessons? U.S. officials discovered information about what many at the time called the Russian War in four basic ways: newspapers, combatant data relayed by Americans in Europe, first-hand accounts of U.S. observers, and post-conflict studies. The Telegraph and the dedicated war correspondent combined for unprecedented reportage as major newspapers throughout the country carried hundreds of articles about the conflict. Soldiers, even those garrisoned at isolated frontier posts that usually had to wait a month for newspapers, closely reviewed the latest dispatches. Yet as Jay Luvas points out, these articles lacked desired technical data, as most war correspondents were not military men, and like the majority of their readers, they were concerned primarily with general conditions and broad issues. Moreover, news stories often contradicted each other. For example, Commander John Dahlgren, U.S. Navy, the service's foremost ordnance expert, complained that statements about the much-anticipated combat debut of the Lancaster gun, a British rifled muzzle-loading cannon that fired a 68-pound shell, varied so widely that it is difficult to understand that they were speaking of one and the same operation. More detailed and accurate information potentially could be obtained from the combatants. In an era that preceded military attachés, U.S. diplomats, as well as other Americans residing abroad, relayed relevant conversations and gathered documents to the best of their ability. For example, a friend of Secretary Davis in London forwarded to him reports on artillery and logistics in the Crimea. Although helpful, such works suffered from participant bias, removal of sensitive information, and efforts to cast home forces in a positive light. Dahlgren noted that the official French, English, and Russian accounts of the October 1854 Sebastopol naval battle were, altogether wanting in those technical minutiae that the professional inquirer needs. None of the other American sources, for example, doctors volunteering with the Russian army, entrepreneurs seeking weapons contracts, provided data of much value. American officers regarded direct observation by their own kind as vastly superior to the preceding methods. Since 1815, the army had periodically dispatched soldiers to study at European military schools, collect data, and conduct broad-based examinations of the latest military technology and practice. As Secretary of War, Davis was particularly supportive of such efforts. Possessing a rare combination of military experience, political adroitness, and openness to new ideas, the Mississippian in 1853 had reluctantly left his position as chairman of the Senate Committee on Military Affairs. His close relationship with President Pierce, a fellow Mexican War veteran who ardently lobbied Davis to join the administration, proved a valuable resource. Robert Utley characterizes him as the ablest and best qualified Secretary of War in the 19th century. Matthew Moten adds that while Davis had shown a capacity for original thought, he was eager to learn from others. Secretary Davis recognized that the Anglo-French failure to capture Sebastopol before the first winter created an opportunity for American observation of the fighting. He first contemplated establishing a commission in December 1854 or early 1855, but its belated formation that spring possibly resulted from a delay in obtaining President Pierce's approval. For this mission, Davis chose three well-regarded officers after his friend Colonel Joseph Mansfield and possibly Lieutenant Colonel Robert E. Lee rejected participation. Major Richard Delafield, superintendent of New York Harbor defenses and a member of the Board of Engineers, led the delegation and focused on fortifications. Moten, author of the most authoritative account of the commission, notes that observing a war that had degenerated into a siege of a port city was an excellent assignment for a man of his talents. Davis tapped Major Alfred Mordecai, commandant of the Washington Arsenal and a long-standing member of the Ordnance Board, to cover artillery and small arms. A relentless data collector and excellent scientist, Moten points out that no officer in the Army was better qualified to investigate the technical aspects of foreign weaponry. Much younger and recently transferred from the Corps of Engineers to the cavalry, Captain George McClellan would be the third member with primary responsibility for infantry and especially cavalry insights. The extremely ambitious McClellan, the only participant with combat experience, had previously undertaken sensitive missions for Davis. In meeting with the commissioners before their April 11, 1855 departure, the secretary identified 11 areas to which it is particularly desirable to direct your attention. Topics of interest ranged from the latest on weapons and fortifications to logistics and field medicine. But the trio had the latitude to explore what they deemed noteworthy. Although responsible for investigating military developments throughout Europe, Davis urged the commissioners to proceed as soon as possible to the theater of war in the Crimea for the purpose of observing the active operations in that quarter. He also wanted the trio, if possible, to visit the Baltic theater before their expected November 1855 return. Davis, however, had not obtained permission for battlefield visits, only writing the relevant U.S. ambassadors to give as much assistance as possible. Unfortunately, only 6 months earlier, the U.S. representatives to France and Great Britain had played key roles in the Ostend Manifesto as part of an unabashed U.S. effort to annex Cuba, alienating their host governments and exacerbating the difficulty of obtaining clearance for Crimean travel. Nevertheless, Delafield, Mordecai, and McClellan enthusiastically headed for Great Britain with the intention of visiting the Allied side first. While in England, they explored military facilities and warships, observed weapon demonstrations, and received a valuable war account from the recently returned Lieutenant General John Burgoyne. Despite crises still periodically threatening a third U.S.-UK war, the British government provided introductory letters to its land and naval commanders in the Crimean theater. Disappointment, however, soon followed when the French government proved uncooperative, making approval of a frontline visit conditional on the Americans not subsequently traveling to the Russian side. Given the French Army's historically close relationship with the U.S. Army and the latter's accommodation of a French military observer, the Marquis de Radepont, during the Mexican-American War, the attitude in Paris frustrated the delegation. Its persistence prompted the commissioners to adopt something of an anti-French bias. After 3 weeks idling in France, the Americans departed for Russia in the hopes of obtaining access to the Crimean defenders. Reflecting the Tsar's desire to ally with the United States, the Russians openly welcomed the group with tours of military forces, arsenals, and some key fortifications. Still, Alexander II, who had become ruler only that March, would not grant permission to enter the Crimean Peninsula, citing the local commander's opposition to neutral observers. Blocked by both sides from the war zone, Mordecai complained in June 1855 that, "Since we left England, we have been much less informed of the events and details of the war than we were at home." The failure of a major June 1855 assault on Sebastopol prompted the Americans to believe they could visit Prussia before heading toward the Crimea in the hope of gaining clearance. Their assessment would be mistaken, as news reached the group in Prussia on September 8th that the Allies had finally captured Sebastopol. The dismayed commissioners hurried to the war zone, reaching Constantinople in 9 days, and after a 20-day wait, received British approval for a passage to Balaclava. The Americans arrived in the Crimea on October 8, 1855. Although frustrated about missing active combat, the group obtained valuable information as they toured the battlefields daily and seemed to have worked harder during this part of their trip than at any other time. In particular, the commissioners benefited from exploring the captured Russian fortifications that had enabled the protracted defense and the British siege works used to defeat them. The French, however, continued to be obstructionist, and the Russians would not allow the Americans access to their new positions. Given that opposing forces now occupied opposite sides of the harbor, the siege of Sebastopol and the artillery duel, the war's salient novel characteristic, were still ongoing, offering a glimpse of the action. After 3 weeks of investigation, including trips to the Alma and Inkerman battlefields, the delegation headed for Constantinople to explore support operations. From the Ottoman capital, Delafield wrote Davis that, "It is believed that, as a general rule, the information contemplated in our instructions has been procured to a useful extent." The secretary closely observed this letter and another 20-plus updates that provided preliminary observations. 2 months after Davis wrote how anxious he was for their overdue return, the three weary travelers arrived in New York City on April 29, 1856. Given the importance he attached to the effort, Davis, unsurprisingly, met with the commissioners only 4 days later. Whereas Delafield, McClellan, and especially Mordecai had at one time feared their mission would be a much criticized failure, this session confirmed prior correspondence that their views had enormous potential to influence the Army's future. Yet although Davis made clear that he desired their reports to be printed as soon as possible, decisions by both him and the commission delayed their completion and diminished the quality. In mid-May, Delafield reported to Davis that each member planned to write a separate account on his particular areas of investigation. Besides avoiding the potentially painful effort to reconcile views, this approach allowed the three to write in different cities. The secretary initially pushed back, but he capitulated, likely because of a desire for Delafield and Mordecai to perform other duties. Wanting to revise the Army's general regulations before leaving office, Davis tasked the capable Mordecai with this assignment. Mordecai's participation on the Delafield Commission almost certainly contributed to his selection, given that, as Michael Bonura points out, the 1857 regulations had more of a battlefield focus. In a war department that wanted to refocus the army regulations on European-style warfare and decisive battle. Meanwhile, problems at West Point prompted Delafield's reappointment as superintendent, a position he held from 1838 to 1854. In his 1856 annual report, the secretary lamented the necessity of these actions. As a result, McClellan's rapidly completed report, published in early 1857, would be the only one available internally before mid-1858, and the only one published before mid-1860. Still, findings about the Crimean War reached key audiences. The Secretary of War referenced lessons in every annual report in the mid-1850s, as did some supplementary statements by the commanding general and bureau chiefs. In particular, Davis's 1856 annual report, the first after the observers returned, reveals how greatly the commission's work had influenced him. To facilitate its composition, the secretary had received from Delafield a 32-page general outline envisioned for his final report, as well as input from McClellan and Mordecai. McClellan's work received considerable attention, exemplified by Dennis Hart Mahan and Major William Hardy incorporating parts into their West Point courses. Mordecai and Delafield had ample opportunity earlier to transmit their primary insights to Corps Army bodies. Mordecai was now the most important member of the influential Ordnance Board, while the well-connected Delafield was the service's leading advocate for coastal fortifications. Post-war examinations built on the commissioner's efforts, writing that the Russian retreat to the north side of Sebastopol and the French assault upon the Malakoff must each be regarded as a masterpiece of its kind, McClellan recommended they receive the closest study. Focusing on naval assaults of coastal fortifications, Delafield asserted that it is the bounden duty of the officers of our Army and Navy to study this branch of the art of war. Younger officers, such as Captain John Gibbon and First Lieutenant Cadmus Wilcox, attempted to extrapolate from this experience. In 1858, the influential Professor Mahan commenced a major revision of his text, Permanent Fortifications, weighing evidence from the recent conflict. In his second edition of Elements of Military Art and Science, retired captain and highly respected defense intellectual Henry Halleck also addressed activity, especially field engineering, which had received its greatest development and most brilliant application in the Crimean War, particularly in the siege of Sebastopol. The Navy undertook no effort like the Delafield Commission. Secretary of the Navy James Dobbin had good reason to reject Farragut's request, given the latter's import and establishment of the West Coast's first naval yard, but he initiated no search to find a substitute or create an investigatory body. Dobbin may have been a godfather of modern American sea power, but he lacked Davis's commitment to learn from the Crimean War. The decision stemmed not only from differences between the secretaries, but from the Navy's operating context. Usually forward-deployed sailors frequently interacted with their European counterparts, diminishing the incentive for an extraordinary wartime initiative. For example, Captain Samuel DuPont and Commander Andrew Foote, among other American naval officers, spent time in the late 1850s with British and French forces attacking Chinese barrier forts during the Taiping Rebellion. Over the previous four decades, American sailors had undertaken far less exploratory European trips than their Army counterparts, with most such efforts involving naval ordnance experts. Still, the Navy had indirect and idiosyncratic opportunities to obtain combat insights. In 1854, Dobbin sent Engineer-in-Chief Daniel Martin and Lieutenant Walker to Europe to examine the latest technological developments, for example, steam machinery, screw propellers, before choosing among submitted proposals for the six newly funded Merrimack-class frigates. Neither Martin nor Walker apparently ventured to war zones, but the USS Cumberland, flagship of the Mediterranean Squadron, observed British and French vessels' initial preparations. Most notably, the aforementioned porter, one of the service's most talented officers, reached Sebastopol just after its capture. He had been dispatched with Army Captain Henry Wayne to the Middle East to acquire camels as part of a War Department experiment on whether this beast of burden could ease frontier supply difficulties. Porter journeyed to the Crimean Peninsula, ostensibly to collect data on the use of camels. But the inquisitive officer also visited the Malakoff fortification, inspected the innovative French ironclad floating battery, even making a model, and investigated improved British-French underwater explosives. The lieutenant relayed his findings to the Navy Department in lengthy reports. Dahlgren also believed there is much to be gleaned from the incidents of this war. His seminal 1856 work, Shell and Shell Guns, concludes with a 125-page examination of the Crimean War's maritime component. A need to rely heavily on official accounts for the facts that underlay his analysis, however, prompted Dahlgren to warn that the actors in the eventful drama are too recently from its thrilling scenes to be inclined to the sober duties of the chronicler. Still, the Navy captain likely benefited from a friendship with Mordecai in drawing his assessment. What Dahlgren learned is part of the next section, but his study represents the primary U.S. naval appraisal of the conflict. What lessons did the Americans identify? Less than 5 years after the Delafield Commission returned, the U.S. Civil War commenced in Charleston's harbor. It is helpful to review the critical military features of that existential struggle to facilitate consideration of what study of the Crimean War could have revealed to enable better preparedness. The opposing sides organized, maintained, maneuvered, and fought armies far larger than any prior American force. With the standard infantry weapon being a rifled musket, soldiers inflicted much more lethal fire, especially when defending. While improved field artillery added to the destructiveness of battle, larger rifled guns rendered heretofore strong masonry fortifications highly vulnerable. Such works were most expeditiously overcome by Army-Navy cooperation, which, when employed, facilitated the U.S. military outmaneuvering and defeating Confederate forces. Steam propulsion, armor protection, and enhanced armament enabled the U.S. Navy to isolate the Confederate States of America by closing its primary ports. Some of these key Civil War elements echoed Crimean combat, while others entailed significant departures. Combatants in the earlier conflict demonstrated the increased scale of war, potential for moving significantly larger forces, value of Army-Navy cooperation, utility of railroads and telegraph, and availability of better field artillery. The fighting also showed the naval benefits from improved armament, armor, and propulsion for blocking enemy ports. Yet study of the Crimean War would not have led one to expect the essential obsolescence of masonry fortification because the employed rifled artillery performed poorly. Moreover, although elite troops possessed rifled muskets, most soldiers did not have such arms, preventing the generation of clear lessons about their lethal impact. The subsequent discussions of what the U.S. military discovered from the Crimean War primarily reflects the Delafield Commission's findings, but includes inputs from other contemporary commentators. Before commencing this discussion, a few caveats regarding the delegation's information. First, I focus on war-related topics, but drawing a sharp distinction between their Crimean War and non-Crimean findings is sometimes not possible. Second, the delayed completion and publication of two of the three commissioners' reports resulted in their correspondence and oral discussions playing a critical role in information transmission. The passage of years between the Delafield Commission's return and the final published accounts created a possibility of insights being influenced by subsequent events. This development may have happened minimally, but evidence is lacking of a lesson being significantly altered, so I use material from the published reports when discussing the findings and their application in the late 1850s. enlightening lessons. Unprecedented scale of warfare and ability to project power. Although the Delafield Commission provided no sweeping synthesis of the war's lessons, its members identified two overarching themes. First, increasing industrialization facilitated violence on an unprecedented scale, far beyond the U.S. military's prior experience or preparation. They characterized this quantitative change as more salient than any identified qualitative shift in weapons or tactics. Given that the battle for Sebastopol essentially became an artillery duel, the Americans, not surprisingly, focused on that aspect. They noted by October 1855 that the ruined port had absorbed 2.4 million rounds of shot and shell from an Allied arsenal of 2,500 guns. Second, the British and French militaries demonstrated the enormous power projection capability of steam-powered navies with potentially grave consequences for U.S. security. Allied navies landed sizable armies on the Crimean Peninsula at Eurotria, from which they rapidly fought their way 50 miles south to Sebastopol, and likely would have immediately captured it under better leadership. Davis warned in his 1856 annual report that remoteness from the great naval powers of the world can therefore no longer be considered as giving our commercial cities immunity from the danger of a sudden descent. Benefit from Army-Navy cooperation. The Americans stressed that the conflict reinforced the timeless lesson of soldier-sailor teamwork, which greatly enhanced combat effectiveness, especially when attacking coastal fortifications. Although Sebastopol's strong shore works stymied the British and French navies, U.S. analysts highlighted that the Allies obtained victory by overcoming the weaker landside defenses. After cautioning that purely naval action on coastal works was unlikely to succeed, Dahlgren argued that the issue assumed a totally different aspect when connected with an assault by land. Likewise, Delafield emphasized that harbor defenses were of no value without being properly protected in the rear. He added that the Russians staved off defeat for almost a year by rapidly redeploying large army and naval guns. But the U.S. lacked such resources with which to erect effective temporary land defenses. Evolving Allied wartime practice suggested future operations would involve joint land-sea advances. Commentators added that the increased mobility of armies transported by steam-powered ships enhanced this lesson's significance. Value of torpedo mines. One clear positive for defenders was the effective Russian use of torpedo mines. Inventors, such as Samuel Colt, had long failed to interest U.S. soldiers and sailors in mines. The besieged Russians, benefiting from Emmanuel Nobel's design, employed large numbers of submerged, moored, contact, as well as electrically controlled devices to protect naval bases and strategic waterways. Inadequate charges diminished physical destruction, but they prompted considerable caution among Allied naval captains after four vessels detonated explosives at Kronstadt early in the war. Although noting their impact, Delafield provided limited details as the Russians treated the mines as a tightly guarded secret. I found no American commentary on the unprecedented British minesweeping effort. Floating battery. Impressive debut. The British and French introduced innovative warships, especially the floating battery, that enhanced their ability to attack coastal fortifications. The concept, combining powerful steam engines, shallow draft, large guns, and iron plating, had existed for many years, but navies ignored these unconventional, inelegant-looking vessels until the Allies adopted them out of necessity. After observing their construction in England, the Delafield Commission sent Davis a special report in May 1855. During their combat debut 4 months later, French floating batteries advanced much closer than the rest of the fleet, each receiving at least 40 hits without suffering significant damage, and contributing significantly to the rapid fall of Fort Kinburn. Leading British war correspondent William Howard Russell declared that the success of the experiment, iron-cased batteries, is complete. But American reports, though positive, were not so definitive. Porter found the French ship he visited quite impressive, while Delafield warned that floating batteries can cross the Atlantic. U.S. commentators pointed out that their steam power and shallow draft enabled attacking from unanticipated directions. The reserved Dahlgren found them formidable and requiring countermeasures, but cautioned that assessing their value requires further confirmation of their asserted invulnerability, especially given his expectation of coastal fortifications employing heavier cannon. Delafield and Dahlgren added that small mortar vessels, which also could cross the Atlantic, presented difficult targets for Russian gunners while inflicting meaningful damage. Superior new French 12-pound gun. For ground forces, the performance of one weapon stood out: the new French light 12-pound smoothbore gun. Although the scientist soldier Mordecai unemotionally documented weapons ranging from small arms to monster siege guns, even he expressed enthusiasm for this armament based on its contribution to operations at Sebastopol. The ordnance expert explained that the versatile field gun was both lighter and more durable than its predecessors, could be employed as a cannon or howitzer, and fired all ammunition types, greatly simplifying logistics. Delafield added that its outstanding battlefield performance, a material change for field guns, had prompted other European powers to rush into production versions of the French piece. Still, the judicious Mordecai cautioned it may be doubted whether the experience of the Russian war was sufficient to establish the efficacy of these pieces for all the service that may be required of field artillery. Utility of iron gun carriages. Even though the commissioners disagreed somewhat on lessons regarding larger garrison and siege artillery, as will be discussed, they seized on a small but valuable support innovation. The Europeans, who like the Americans suffered from rotted and warped wooden ordnance carriages, shifted to iron alternatives. In particular, they found that the wrought iron used by the Russians proved more durable than the initial British and French preference for cast iron. Need for greater logistical support. Finally, although less interesting than weapons or fortifications, the Americans noted that the expanded scale of siege trains and expeditionary forces required far greater management and support. For the British, the challenge had proven too demanding in the first Crimean winter, resulting in such atrocious losses through deprivation and disease that newspaper accounts of this misery led to the Aberdeen government's collapse. Their logistics improved significantly by the second winter, when the French had a much harder time. As indicated by support-related questions composing almost half of the subjects with which Davis explicitly tasked the Delafield Commission, this area was important to the War Department. The commissioners related how railroads assisted British and French advancement of men and materiel from the disembarkation points to the front line. Praising this innovative and necessary effort, Delafield remarked that for the first time, railroads had been employed in presence of an enemy. With regard to the care and feeding of soldiers, Delafield's report was encyclopedic in scope, including medical and camp equipment. When first arriving in England, the Americans heard about the long-lasting dehydrated food that had been developed for the field armies and supplied the War Department with a sample. Delafield would later add that widespread use of such prepared food by both sides proved its value. Misleading lessons. Masonry coastal fortifications remain stout. While the preceding observations conveyed helpful information, U.S. officials with equal diligence and confidence relayed other findings that, although accurate, would not be in the near future. Most notably, the Americans viewed the conflict as indicating that strengthening masonry coastal fortifications represented the best response to the aforementioned increased threat from expeditionary forces. Given that the continuing effectiveness of stone and brickworks in light of new gun technology had been a hotly debated subject in the pre-war years, policymakers, not surprisingly, looked to the conflict for guidance. Noting that the danger the U.S. had risked from neglect of coastal fortification, Delafield highlighted the severe test to which these casemated defenses were subjected in proof of their efficiency and reliability. Army Chief Engineer Colonel Joseph Totten added that the failure of British and French attacks on Russian works illustrated that well-constructed strongholds can resist the greatest expeditions, although not improvised structures. Similarly, McClellan stressed that Crimean war operations showed the value of a wise and proper permanent fortification system. In his December 1856 annual report, Davis, after discussions with the returned commissioners, declared that the war's combat appeared to show conclusively that properly constructed fortifications are a sure reliance against the most formidable fleets. Navy Secretary Dobbin, in his annual report that same month, acknowledged that recent developments in the late European wars will hardly encourage such naval assaults to be often undertaken. After weighing the fighting, Dahlgren judged that the introduction of heavy shells is more advantageous to the fort than to the ship, and noted how naval gunnery struggled against elevated fortifications such as at Cape Constantine. He added that the critical caveat that works which are less complete in all respects cannot, however, be assumed as impregnable. Rifled artillery ineffective. Information on the rifled artillery's disappointing performance boosted the lesson of masonry fortifications' resiliency. Davis had explicitly tasked the commissioners to evaluate the performance of long-range rifled guns. The much-hyped British Lancaster greatly increased artillery range, but Delafield and Mordecai reported that it proved wildly inaccurate and fragile. Dahlgren simply stated that the conflict attested to its entire failure in service. Given poor results at Sebastopol and Bomarsund, use of the Lancasters diminished as the war progressed, and the Admiralty dropped plans to put them on warships. Beyond this weapon, Mordecai reported that no cannon of extraordinary caliber or range, no breech-loading guns, no rifled cannon, except the Lancaster gun, were put to the test of actual service. The Americans did at least qualify this overarching finding by noting that the Europeans would continue to develop rifled artillery and urging the U.S. Army and U.S. Navy to do likewise. Delafield observed that the increased range of British and French non-rifled naval shell guns meant it was necessary to carry the defenses of any point at least 7,000 yards in advance of it. Thus, he pointed out the value of detached outer works and the use of long-range weapons in coastal fortifications. Dahlgren and Delafield reported that the fighting demonstrated, as the former wrote, that the new motor steam propulsion is entirely adverse to the fort. The Americans explained that the elimination of sails and masts significantly reduced targets, while crippled vessels, unless catastrophically damaged in the engine space, moved expeditiously out of danger. Most significantly, naval commanders could now orchestrate attacks with far greater precision, each ship in its place. Missed lessons. Command and control challenges. Despite not arriving until after the crux of the fighting concluded, the salient information neglected by the commissioners was mostly due to a lack of interest. The most legitimate complaint rests on a failure to appreciate the increased command and control difficulties resulting from the greater scale and mobility of forces. The Americans appreciated the transformational role of the England to Crimea telegraph. Not surprisingly, Delafield judged it was so far unquestionably useful when communicating Army needs home, but its advantage was somewhat questionable when carrying government orders to commanders. He added that the British also effectively used telegraph lines to send messages between the forward trenches, headquarters, and depots. The increased information flow enhanced situational awareness, but effective management required more than communication. J.D. Hittel emphasizes that, with the conflict's overwhelming demands, it became unmistakably apparent that British staff organization was not capable of coping with war requirements. Mordecai believed that the British Army's response of establishing a Chief of the Staff office best explained its Army's improved management after the first winter. This insight aside, the Americans displayed little interest in staff operations, a critical task that would bedevil large American field forces during the Civil War. The absence of any American observer with significant staff experience likely contributed to this neglect. Cavalry concerns. Given that the war's infamous Charge of the Light Brigade indicated the horse's diminishing role in battle, and a Davis-directed emphasis on obtaining cavalry lessons, the Americans could also be charged with failure in this area. Understandably, the combat use of horse soldiers on the battlefield, a la the British during the Battle of Balaclava, was not the way U.S. cavalry had been historically employed, and thus was of minimal interest. Rather, commissioner attempts to identify best practices regarding equipment, training, and organization came more from their travels across the continent than Crimean fighting. For example, superiority of a Hungarian saddle, preference for breech-loading guns. Despite Russian regular officers' criticism of the Cossacks, McClellan and Mordecai praised them as ideal light cavalry. McClellan argued that their intelligence, mobility, endurance, and reliability fit well with the reconnaissance, escort, and messaging missions relevant on the American frontier. Desiring applicable lessons, even at the cost of accuracy, left McClellan particularly susceptible to being swayed by both foreigners, for example Russians, and friends at home, for example Lieutenant Colonel Joseph Johnston. Unclear lessons. Rifled muskets' impact. Much of the modern criticism about the U.S. military's battlefield ignorance at the outset of the Civil War comes from a mistaken belief that the Crimean War clearly signaled the increased range and lethality of small arms and need to modify infantry tactics accordingly. With the U.S. infantry in the process of transitioning from smoothbore to rifled muskets and rewriting what then passed for doctrine, the Crimean War's timing seemed fortuitous. Alas, it did not provide conclusive data on hotly debated questions about this weapon. As an ordnance expert, Mordecai concentrated on the relative performance of gun types, while McClellan emphasized Russian valor and discipline, and French fencing, gymnastic, and marksmanship training. Assessing the tactical implications of rifled muskets would have been difficult even if the observers had focused on the subject, given the surprisingly limited use of this weapon. Essentially, only British and French light infantry units and other elite elements on both sides fielded these guns, with most soldiers equipped with smoothbore muskets. As a result, fighting usually occurred at close range. Thus, Mordecai reported that the combat did not allow of a full trial of the effect of the new arms and of their influence on the tactics of armies. Although the absence of widespread use of rifled muskets precluded an overarching assessment, these weapons' limited employment generated some salient observations about their danger and how to counteract them. Mordecai noted that the Sebastopol siege served to develop the importance of these arms of long-range, rifled guns, as an auxiliary in both the attack and defense of places. Facilitating the use of and protection from rifles, pits dug out from the ground had been increasingly employed by the Russians in front of their Sebastopol works. McClellan explained that they contributed very materially towards impeding the progress of advancing British and French troops. the Americans characterized these obstacles, which ranged from single-person positions to small lunettes holding 10 to 20 men, as part of the grander scale of entrenchments dug by troops to protect themselves from the battlefield's increasing lethality. Some historians interpret the discussion of rifle pits, or more generally, field fortifications, as indicative of a revised tactical outlook. For example, Edward Hagerman sees in McClellan's report an appreciation that rifled muskets shifted the tactical balance away from open frontal assault. Yet, as Wayne Shea points out, he made no comments on any perceived increase in defensive firepower created by the rifle musket's increased accuracy. The demonstrated danger from the increased range of rifled muskets prompted Mordecai to recommend for the field artillery spherical case shot, anti-personnel round, as one of the most effectual means of defense. Earthworks utility. For some issues, the difficulty was not a lack of available data, but divergence on how to interpret its meaning. This case offers two examples of this challenge related to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.